This is Standing Watch. And now, Evangelist Norbert Link.
Greetings, everyone, and welcome back to our Standing Watch program. It was a long time coming. Airstrikes in Iraq, arming Syrian rebels. Now airstrikes in Syria. America is at war. Again, another war is going on. A war which will drag on. A war which America is not going to win, as America has not won any war since World War II. My friends, there are reasons for that. There are reasons for the fact that we do not learn from history. But let's first of all give a little bit of background. Here's an article by Breitbart, dated September 19, 2014, where Senator Rand Paul was quoted saying this: "If the Syrian rebels are to win, even the moderate rebels, how many of them do you think will recognize Israel? None. How many of them do you think might turn their arms against Israel? Maybe quite a few. In fact, some of them have said that their goal is to take back the Golan Heights if they can defeat Assad. I think that the one truism of the Middle Eastern morass is that when we have hoped or when we have toppled secular dictators, chaos has ensued and the rise of radical Islam has occurred. Whether this was Hussein being toppled, Mubarak being toppled, Gaddafi being toppled, or potentially Assad being toppled, what comes in their wake is worse than what we had." And that, my friend, is absolutely true if we are honest. Think of the debacle regarding Afghanistan, which you didn't even mention. Every time we try to bring about peace through war, we are defeated. The Washington Post wrote on September 19, because let me just say, it's not only the White House, it's not only the president who are to be blamed for this present fiasco. Before the U.S. military attacked Saddam Hussein's forces in 1991, Congress spent months considering its approval of the war. 12 years later, another attack on Iraq came after 3 weeks of debate and intensive negotiations. But this week, the House and Senate each took only a few hours to sign off on President Obama's plan to once again deploy the military in the Middle East, approving it as part of a broader budget bill before bounding out of town for a 2 month recess and hitting the midterm campaign trail. Some on Capitol Hill were stunned by the seeming congressional disinterest on a matter of such importance. Now, lawmakers in both parties are asking the uncomfortable question: has Congress forfeited its rightful role in the most solemn of all national decisions? A good question. A very good question. What is going on with our leadership? What is going on with those who are supposed to rule and to lead the United States of America? The Huffington Post wrote on September 20, because just don't blame the Obama administration, just don't blame Congress. If you want to blame somebody, blame yourself. Because here's what is being said: Americans remain big supporters of airstrikes against the Islamic State militants, even though few think they will do any good. Come again? So we are supporting airstrikes thinking they won't do any good? Why then the airstrikes? Goes on to say that 66% of Americans now support the decision to conduct airstrikes against the Islamic State, even though only 32%, less than half, of those who support it, they think taking such action against the Islamic State will improve the situation in Iraq and Syria. Now, let me also point out that even though many Americans support the airstrikes, and Congress kind of supports it too, I guess, they haven't really said one way or the other, but we are dealing with broken promises here. Broken promises. Because the Associated Press, this is before the most recent airstrikes against Syria started, they asked already on September 20 the following pertinent question: President Barack Obama's military campaign against the Islamic State group already has extended beyond the limits he first outlined. But military experts inside and outside the administration argue that an even greater expansion may be needed for the mission to succeed, including positioning U.S. ground troops. Now, of course, President Obama has been saying time and again, no ground troops, no boots on the ground, but that's going to happen. I'm telling you, that is going to happen. But here, there are already those who are advocating that. It says, doing that could put Obama close to violating his pledge to keep Americans out of combat. But he said more than that, because the article goes on to say, for Obama, re-engaging in combat in Iraq would mean going back on promises about the current mission and undercutting a pillar of his presidency, ending long wars and avoid new ones. He is not avoiding new ones. America is not avoiding new ones. We are right in the middle of one. And so the New York Times wrote on September 22 that the United States and Arab allies launched airstrikes against Sunni militants in Syria early Tuesday, unleashing a torrent of cruise missiles and precision-guided bombs from the air and sea on the militants' de facto capital of Raqqa and along the Iraq border. The strikes are a major turning point in President Obama's war against the Islamic State and open up a risky new stage of the American military campaign. And on the uncomfortable story goes. The Washington Post wrote on September 23, in ordering the attacks, Obama also thrust the U.S. military directly into Syria's devastating civil war, something that he had steadfastly tried to avoid. It also goes on in this article to say that the Turks are not going to allow the Americans to conduct airstrikes from their territory. Now, that may change. We don't know. But at this point, France has agreed to airstrikes against Iraq, and they have already done one. But they are not going to participate in airstrikes against Syria, and Germany has totally ruled out having anything to do with any of it. Now, of course, the reaction was predictable. Russia, Iran, and also Lebanon condemned the airstrikes. We have just heard that there are more and more who try to convince the president that we should have boots on the ground. And as I said, I believe that that is going to happen, and that will again get us into a war similar to the Afghan situation, similar to Vietnam, similar to Korea. Because let's not forget, when the Afghan war situation started, the representation was made, we only will have airstrikes. That's all we are going to have. And soon thereafter, of course, we had boots on the ground. The Welt, a German paper, wrote that America's airstrikes really are nothing but acts of desperation. Now, interestingly enough, it's also quite revealing how our leadership changes their convictions, changes their minds. The National Review wrote on September 23 that Joe Biden mocked Romney at the time, saying that Romney said it was a mistake to end the war in Iraq and bring all our warriors home. And then he also said this, Biden that is. He said it was a mistake to set an end for our warriors in Afghanistan and bring them home. He implies by the speech that he is ready to go to war in Syria and Iran. And then he says he wants to move from cooperation to confrontation with Putin's Russia. And these guys say the president's out of touch. It's interesting, Biden now has to eat what he said, what he mocked, what he scoffed. Now he is the subject of scoff himself. But President Obama also made some terrible statements because he dismissed F-22 fighter jets as outdated and unnecessary in a speech on July 21, 2009. But according to the Wall Street Journal of September 22, 2014, the U.S. used F-22 fighter jets in their airstrikes against ISIS and also the Khorasan targets in Syria, Khorasan, an offshoot of Al-Qaeda. Der Spiegel Online wrote that the F-22 fighter jets are the most sophisticated and powerful and important fighter jets which the United States has. Now you answer all of that. What a terrible picture of confusion, and I might say incompetency, is being revealed here. The Bible has long foretold that that is what's going to happen. The Bible has long foretold that the United States is not going to win another war prior to the return of Jesus Christ. And the Bible has also told us very clearly why that is. Our free booklet on the fall and rise of Britain and America will give you the answers. If you haven't read that yet, please do. But I'd like to read a few scriptures to you now, which also give you a little bit of a hint. I'd like to read from the book of Hosea. In chapter 4 and verse 7, it says, "The more my people multiplied, the more they sinned against me." In Hosea chapter 5 and verse 4, "Your deeds won't let you come to God again." In Hosea chapter 8 and verse 4, "They set up kings without my consent. They choose princes without my approval." You might also refer that to the president, to senators, congressmen, etc., etc. Hosea 8 and verse 12, "I have written for him the great things of my law, but they were considered a strange thing." Yes, nobody cares about God's law these days. Nobody cares about the fact that God tells true Christians not to fight in war. They think they have to do it. They think they can bring about peace through war, something which will never, ever happen, which has never happened in the history of man. But who cares about what God says? Another one, Hosea chapter 13, verse 6. "But when you had eaten and were satisfied, then you became proud and forgot me." Yes, you thought you can work out your problems yourself, and you can't. You see, America is no better than any other nation. The American people are no better than any other people. Because, you see, what does it say in Romans chapter 3 and in verse 9? Paul is saying, what then? Are we better than they? Not at all. As it is written, "There is none righteous, no, not one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. They have all turned aside. They have together become unprofitable. There is none who does good, no, not one. Their throat is an open tomb. With their tongues they have practiced deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways. The way of peace they haven't known. There is no fear of God before their eyes." Does this ring any bells? Isn't that a very clear description of humankind today, no matter in what country we might be living? You see, my friends, there is a time which is prophesied in the Bible, in the book of Isaiah, in the second chapter, also in the sixth chapter, which talks about the time when man will finally understand who and what he is, that war will never bring about peace. And then they will come to the point when Jesus Christ is ruling this earth, that they are unwilling to learn war anymore. And they will take their weapons and they will use them for useful tools of agriculture and other useful things. The time will come where war is a thing of the past. That time hasn't come yet. Today we are living in a world of war ruled by Satan, the devil, the destroyer. But as true Christians, we have to come out of this world. We have to be different. I pray that you are one who is going to be different. Thank you very much for listening. This is Norbert Link for the Standing Watch program.
Standing Watch is a presentation by The Church of the Eternal God, P.O. Box 270519, San Diego, California, 92198. More information is also available at our website, eternalgod.org.